some people may still be out in the back room. We're going to encourage them to join us for the second or third, I guess, third part of the program, and then we also have an exciting lunch coming up with Senator Daschle. Let me begin by introducing the panel. We had a panel just now on think tanks and the media, and now we have people who are much more directly engaged in the political world. And I'm going to start here to my left with Anita Dunn, who's the managing director of SKDKnickerbocker, who's been a political strategist for a number of candidates, and most prominently as White House communications director in 2009 and beyond. I think also you may have worked for two of the people in the famous selfie picture that has just been taken and noted in the world, unless you also worked for the Danish prime minister, in which case you've worked for all three. But so I'm going to then introduce next to Anita, David Keating, who's the president of the Center for Competitive Politics, and he's spent a career in a number of nonprofit advocacy groups, including as the executive director of the Club for Growth and also the National Taxpayers Union and Americans for Fair Taxation. Next to David is Eliot Cutler, who is an independent candidate for governor of Maine, was previously a candidate and came very close to becoming the governor of Maine in the last race in 2010 and is running again in 2014, was also a founding partner at Cutler and Stanfield. And then on the far left is Rick Davis. I love the way these things all work out. You know?
It's actually the first time ever to say that about him.
Thank you.
Is Rick Davis, partner and COO of Pegasus Sustainable Century Merchant Bank, and also, again, prominently known as the national campaign manager for John McCain's 2008 presidential campaign. So we have a wealth of experience in the political world across, you know, several dimensions, and just want to begin thinking about the connection of the political world and where these actors see the polarized world. And maybe I can begin with Rick. We saw some earlier on the beginning panel with John Sides and with Rick Pildes. You talk about the polarization of the parties, at least in one sense, that people are much more clearly aligned in their views, that the Republicans agree with Republicans more, Democrats with Democrats. We don't have this world of, you know, very conservative Southern Democrats, very liberal, moderate Republicans. But a lot of the other world tells us that the Republican Party has fractures in it, that we see in the news, at least differences between those who are more, you know, strongly looking to oppose the president and push their views, and those who are, I'd say, more establishment or more institutional. So how do you see the changes in the Republican Party? Do you think that's... Do you think there's a broad agreement in the party and maybe some difference in tactics, or are there real fissures in the party?
Well, I thank you very much for having me here today. This is an unusual opportunity for me to talk about something that, you know, we as practitioners have to deal with all the time. I think that it really is a historical issue that is present in the Republican Party depending upon certain economic cycles, right? So I first noticed the fissure in our party when I was involved in a campaign in 1988 and 1992 with the rise of sort of the Ross Perot movement, right? That was the first time we'd seen sort of a break-off group, you know, within the Republican Party. It was bad economic times. You know, there's a wing of our party that are sort of, I would say, burn the government down, Republicans, where if the economy's bad, they multiply in number and they show up in pretty strong advocacy roles, especially in primary elections. The economy improved during the Clinton administration and they disappeared, right? I mean, Ross Perot went from getting almost 20% as an independent, but he was really came from the right part of our party. You saw the impact on that election. Disgorging the Republican presidential candidate at the time. And then things calm down. You know, Bob Dole gets the nomination. People like Steve Forbes and Pat Buchanan can't get any traction whatsoever. Good economic times. Bad economic times comes back and we see the rise of the Tea Party. Sort of a warmed over Ross Perot movement from what I can tell within the Republican Party. So part of it's driven by economics, in my view. You see those cycles repeat themselves pretty regularly, and it's a very similar strain within the party. I mean, all parties have ideological differences within their party, And we certainly have one that looks very different than the mainstream, right? They're, instead of being free markets, internationalists, they are, you know, sort of close the markets, protectionists, you know, and that's all in the same party. It used to be the Democrats were the only protectionists. And yet, if the further right you go in our spectrum, you hit this sort of ledge and you fall off, and there they are. So they're there all the time, they just, whether or not they're very active or not. And obviously, because of the impact of the 2008 crash and the ensuing, you know, economic and political chaos that has taken place, there was a significant increase. When I was running John McCain's presidential race in 2008, there was no such thing as a Tea Party member. Didn't exist. Not one single person showed up at a town hall or in a primary vote that called themselves a Tea Partier. 4 years later, 2 years later, it's the biggest single impact in electoral politics that cycle. So I think it's cyclical, and I think sometimes you see the same kinds of cycles, you know, that occur in the Democratic Party. I think if we could get to a point where you'd see a level of prosperity and economic growth in our country, you'd probably see a decline in the influence of the Tea Party. You still have to deal with it as a party, but I'm not sure it's anything other than a cyclical trend.
So if I could turn to Anita, who's sitting on the other end here. You could say the Democratic Party, certainly in the 1990s with Bill Clinton, was trying to reestablish itself as a major party, having been out of power for 12 years. But today, I think the general meme in the media is that the Democratic Party is fairly united for a big, broad party we have in a two-party system, and it's the Republicans who have all those problems. Tell us a little bit what you see on the inside, whether you think that's true, or whether the fissures are there in your party as well.
Well, the fissures are always there in political parties, but the party that controls the White House tends to be able to paper over them very well because there's a unity behind controlling the White House. And you saw that, I think, under George Bush, where some of what Rick was talking about was very evident, particularly around spending issues. But, you know, the appetite to really go out and challenge a sitting president is not there for most people because there is a sense that at the end of the day, you really want that president to succeed. So much depends on it for your political party. And, you know, and Rick talked about some of the historical fissures in the Republican Party. What is interesting is that if you go right now and you look at some of the far right members of the Republican Party and the farthest left members of the Democratic Party on some economic issues, they actually agree. And it's an interesting thing for us to think about that you have a David Bitter and a Sherrod Brown, for instance, on a too big to fail bill when it comes to Wall Street banks, that these strong arguments out there on either side, there is common ground when you go to the margins, although I wouldn't say to the margins, but there's common ground out there in both those parties. In the Democratic Party, there's been a lot of attention recently to the income inequality issue and the rising visibility of income inequality. That has actually never gone away in our political party. The fissure in the Democratic Party, historically going back to 1968 and the split in 1968 in the party, has been between what was regarded traditionally as the New Deal coalition. Okay, so that you had the what was called the traditional Democratic constituencies. And then the rise of the suburban Democrat, who used to be a Republican, okay, who is more affluent, who's college educated, and who for various reasons over the years, once Gary Hart and George McGovern wrote rules to open up the Democratic Party nominating process, grew more and more powerful. And so if you look at Democratic nominating processes since 1972, there was always an establishment candidate who had the support of the traditional Democratic constituencies, and then there was the other. And the other tended to talk about reform and opening up the political process. The other talked about environmental issues in a way that some members of the traditional coalition weren't always comfortable with. If you think back to some of the fights around clean air and clean water, that was an intra-party fight for us. And that the sort of outsider candidate, whether it was Gary Hart, whether it was Paul Tsongas, whether it was Bill Bradley, or whether it was one of the others who run in that space, tended to appeal to a very different kind of voter. Obama was the candidate who was able to bring together those two splits those two pieces. But I will tell you that the two pieces are still there, and that it is going to be interesting to see what happens in 2016 and moving forward, because clearly part of our progressive wing that grew very strong with Howard Dean around the war is now going very strongly to the income inequality issue. It's a significant issue for this country, but for the Democratic Party, it could be the fissure for 2016.
So let me turn to Eliot. We heard a fair amount about the two political parties of polarization today, and I guess I could put it this way, that there's at least superficial evidence when you look at the number of people who are calling themselves independent today, that there's just a huge body of people who are independent. And then there's other evidence in among consultants and political scientists to say, you know, a lot of those independents, they're pretty loyal to one party or the other. They're pretty loyal to Republicans or Democrats. On the other hand, we have some evidence, which I thought was presented pretty well this morning and some of the literature you had today, that, you know, on issues, that there is much more of a middle, that everyone in the Republican Party doesn't believe in all the things of the Republican Party, everyone in the Democratic Party. So there's some issue positions. But how is it possible for an independent to win? You almost won. You're running again. You think you can win. Who are the people who are your likely supporters, and how do you break them away from, even if they are independents by party registration, how do you break them away from their natural proclivities to follow one party or the other?
You know, when Bob invited me to be on this panel, I was delighted because I thought, here's a chance to go to a zoo and examine aggression and how good the containment policy can be for aggression. But what I've discovered is I've come here and it's like going to the zoo and all the gates are open, the animals are running around, and the zookeepers are congratulating themselves. We have polarization, yes, but it's the consequences of polarization that are troubling most people in America. In Maine today, and you'll pardon me, as Nelson Mandela once said, where you stand depends on where you sit, so I'm going to talk a little bit about Maine as an example. In Maine today, we have a $50 to $100 million hole in the budget, a constitutional requirement that the budget be balanced, a governor who has said, I'm not going to propose a supplemental budget, Democratic legislators who control both houses of legislature say, we're going to do our own budget. The governor says, I'm not going to let you talk to the heads of my departments. The Democrats say, we're not going to talk to the Republicans in the legislature. And people in the state of Maine are looking at this, and they're seeing chaos and dysfunction, and they're throwing their hands up. Now, are they migrating to the endpoints? Yeah, they're migrating to the endpoints, typically, because there's nowhere else for them to go. We have a duopoly. And instead, and it's the first time, and Professor, may I say, it's the first time I've ever heard someone suggest that the cure for the consequences of a duopoly is to strengthen the duopoly. It's all about the money. It's all about the money. And the money, both nationally and in Maine, I believe, is creating the polarization, it's creating the dysfunction. Just for context, in 1974, all of the candidates in the United States who ran for the House and the Senate spent a total of $77 million. And in 2010, to the benefit of Anita and others, they spent $1.8 billion. That's an enormous change. But it's not only the amount that's changed, it's where it's coming from. Huge amounts of money are coming from fewer and fewer sources. So in Maine in 2012, when the Democrats took back both houses of the legislature, most of the money, and when I say most of the money, I mean by far most of the money, came from two labor unions and one person. Now, when this happens over time, there are consequences. The year before I went to work for Ed Muskie in 1966 here in Washington, 21% of all eligible voters in the United States voted in Democratic Party primaries. Not just registered voters, eligibles, 21% of them. In 2010, 8% did. In Maine, last year, in a contest for an open U.S. Senate seat, Olympia Snowes, which happens once in a dog's age, the two nominees from the Republican and the Democratic parties won their place on the general election ballot, their places on the general election ballot, with the votes of a total of 5% of the registered voters in the state of Maine. So what's the consequence in Maine? Well, in Maine, in the last 43 years, we've had one head-to-head race for governor, one. Over the last five gubernatorial elections, independents have won 30%, almost 40% of the vote, and Democrats and Republicans have split the rest, almost evenly, 30 and 30. The duopoly establishes rules. And the rules in Maine disadvantage independents. So independents are doing well in Maine, even in an environment where the duopoly runs the show. So imagine for a minute, you wanted a pair of loafers. And imagine, indeed, that 50% of you want to buy loafers. But you go to the store, and the only thing that's available in the marketplace are either red lace-up shoes or blue lace-up shoes. And if you want loafers, you're out of luck. You got to do something else. In Maine today, if you're a Democrat or a Republican, you can raise money for two political cycles, primary and the general election, even if you don't have an opponent, a primary opponent. But if you're an independent, you have one cycle. If you're a Democrat or Republican, you get to coordinate your campaign with your political party. If you're an independent, you have an independent expenditure committee backing you. You don't. You can't really talk to them at all. And finally, we've had an expropriation of what we used to think of as public interest groups. Once upon a time, public interest groups would rate legislators, rank them, according to their votes. And then they would publicize those rankings and endorse someone who ranked high in those lists. In Maine today, we have the Sierra Club endorsing a candidate for governor who got a 55% rating when he served in the Maine legislature for 17 years. Why? Because the Democratic Party and the Sierra Club are now like this. And so in America today, we have a duopoly, literally, a duopoly in our political system, and enormous numbers of voters are disenfranchised. And I've never seen a duopoly that wants to reform the system of which it is a part. Because they're doing well, and the public interest isn't their principal concern. So I'm an independent. I'm an independent because I'm a reformer, and that's the only place to be.
So just to follow up, I mean, there are a lot of disadvantages, as you mentioned, for independents, and advantages built in for the parties. But across the country it's been difficult, but in Maine, you mentioned, you have a now fairly established tradition of having a significant independent candidate for senatorial, gubernatorial races. So why is that? Because you've got the beachhead, or is there something particular in Maine, and is there a type of voter that you think, if you opened up those same opportunities in other places, would follow the same path?
It's a really good question, John, and I take advantage of it. Obviously, I don't have the answer to the question, except to make this observation. Maine has a history of independent thinking people. We just are. We exercise that independence as a matter of course. And if you look at the people we've sent to Washington, it's a remarkable group of people: Margaret Chase Smith, Ed Muskie, Bill Cohen, Olympia Snowe, Susan Collins, just to name a few, and I probably left out several, and I'll probably hear about it. But it's a remarkable group of people, and I think it's just the character of Yankee independence. It's who we are. But we've also discovered over the course of time, beginning in 1974, that yeah, you can elect independence. You can. There is in this democracy still the opportunity to make real change. You don't have to accept the choices, the limited choices that the duopoly offers you. I think that if I win this time, when I win this time, Maine will be the first state in modern political history to have both an independent senator and an independent governor at the same time. That can spread, and it ought to spread.
So turn to David. I think there are a lot of things you might want to comment. I'm sure you might want to take on the money and politics issue. But one thing I hope you might focus on is this question of primaries. We talked about it in an earlier session. And you know, John Sides and some of the political science research is skeptical that all this running against people in the primaries is really causing the polarization. I think the popular view is, of course, on the right, there are more challenges from a more populist right. With the Club for Growth, you know, some ways you were, you know, at the vanguard of this, bringing candidates to challenge incumbents who sometimes weren't, you know, as faithful to the views of the district as you thought that these more, you know, economically populist candidates would be. So what do you say about? You certainly believed that had an effect. It was a place to play. What's the role of outside groups in primaries, and how do you see this all playing out into the changes in our political system?
Well, it's quite a lot to go over there. I what the Club for Growth PAC did in primaries is it looked first at the open seats because those are the easier seats to win. And I actually don't share Rick's view of the Tea Party and being similar to Ross Perot at all. I think it's a wholly, I think there's some overlap, but I wouldn't call them the same thing at all. I think starting around the year 2000 and even in the late 1990s, there's a strong strain, one of the fissures in the Republican Party, as a tradition of being limited government, constitution, following and things like that, and they saw that a lot of Republicans were just not doing that, and people wanted to see Republicans elected that followed principles of limited government, economic growth, constitutional principles, things like that. And so the logical place to turn over a long period of time is, well, who gets elected? Who influences the caucus over time? Because that's where the ultimate power comes from, the party in Congress, who's in the leadership, and who are among the rank and file. So the logical place to look is, you know, are two places. One is the challengers of the incumbents, because let's face it, most politicians like to get reelected. And so they, I think, if anything, they probably overestimate their chances of losing, but they're risk averse by and large. And even if they win, they don't want to have to go through the extra work of defending a primary challenge, because even if you win, and it's a lot of extra work, you probably just soon not have to do that, right? So there's that, and then the open seats where it's easier to win. And what the club did then and still does today is they look at the candidate's record, they interview the candidates, and they decide which ones really believe in limited government and economic growth, and which ones are just, there's some candidates that run, they just like being famous. There's a big ego factor in being an elected official, and they don't really have any grounding or principles. And so people who are members of the Club for Growth, they like to back the people who believe the same way they do. And you see the same thing in the Democratic primary, but not to the same degree. You have Act Blue and, you know, daily costs and stuff like that, where people are funneling money to people they agree with as well. Same sort of phenomenon.
So, I mean, there's obviously a lot of lamenting in the mainstream press about this, but would you say that there were basically people in office who were not, you know, broadly representative of their districts or their constituents at home, and therefore the primary challenge was really to you know, align that member with the true views of the district? Is that
a fair way to say? Yeah, I think that's fair. is fair.
So, are we going to see more primary challenges on the Democratic side? We have the institutions that David mentioned. Is that likely in the future?
You've had you've had an enormous turnover in both parties of members, and I think one of the and so it seems unlikely you'll see as many primary challenges, frankly, in either party, mostly because you have relatively new members who have recently gone through races and who probably represent their constituencies pretty well. We went through redistricting, so you kind of have a sort of sorting out after redistricting of who should be representing which districts. But there will be primaries. There will be primaries in both parties, and there will be primaries over some fundamental issues that the parties really do agree about, and that parties, need to figure out where they're going to go. I think if you look at the change in the United States Senate and the Democratic Caucus, and you look at how much it's changed just over the last 6 years, so you can see most of those members are fairly well aligned with mainstream Democratic thinking and mainstream Democratic values right now. So it seems unlikely that in the short term you're going to see them. I want to go to something Eliot said though, because I think it's really an interesting thing to look at the New England states. And it's not just Maine, because obviously in Connecticut in the last 10 years, you've had an independent governor and an independent senator get elected. In New Hampshire, I can tell you when Rick and I were on opposite sides in 2000, when Bill Bradley and John McCain were both trying to win their respective New Hampshire primaries, that there were voters in New Hampshire who went to 4 Bradley events and 5 McCain events, trying to figure out who to vote for. There were clearly not aligned people.
In Rhode Island.
Rhode Island, you get it. So that
good news is we got them.
You got enough of them.
Right.
But and so I think it is interesting because you think, okay, can you replicate that model? Because I'm actually a huge believer in competition, and I'm a huge believer that it would not hurt either political party to have to compete a little more. And that rather than trying to do it at the presidential level, which is obviously what's kind of sexy, right, is try to do it there, is that actually doing it at the gubernatorial, congressional, and senatorial level is more realistic. But then you get to states, just as a political consultant, you get to states that are multimedia, that don't have the kind of press corps that you tend to get in a state like Maine, where you actually have 1 or 2 papers that really cover these things, where people talk to each other, where there's a sense of civic participation when you get to some of those larger states. And it's hard to see how you replicate that model.
Well, it's interesting. And what you're really talking about, Anita, is the town meeting tradition, which is very important. But I look at, I'm more hopeful than John, I think, about California. Because in California, there's been a real reform in the rules. The open primary, or the top two primary, if you want to call it that, has the potential, and maybe we saw some sign of it in the functioning of the California legislature in this last year with respect to the budgetary and other reforms that they made. It has the potential of actually creating both competition and choice in a state which has more media and more diversity, both of opinion and everything else, than just about any other state in America. It's going to be interesting to watch that. I don't think people in the, people who are, broadly speaking, economic, fiscal conservatives and social moderates or liberals, and who more or less populate the middle, I don't think that they migrate to both ends of the spectrum by choice. They often migrate there because they have no choice. So I think you're right about competition.
Turn to Rick. I don't want you to delve into the presidential nominating process in great detail, but I guess thinking about the looking ahead to 2016 and looking back to the last two campaigns, the Republicans have not nominated the most conservative candidate. They've nominated establishment candidates, despite a lot of the lamenting that these primaries are driving the most extreme elements. Do you think that looking forward, your party is going to get a fair hearing amongst all the candidates, all the wings of the party, or is the system somehow moving, distorting that because a set of views are being heard that are stronger than they really are in the general election?
No, I think it's a combination of a lot of different factors. One of them is money. Where does the money gravitate to? You know, money is, what did Phil Gramm call it, mother's milk of politics or something like that. And so, you know, money's going to find its way to candidates that, that they think, you know, either are winnable or carry a message that they think is what they want to pay for. Two, the system is amazingly resilient in the sense that it very rarely changes, right? We've got the same five or six states that nominate our candidates for the last two decades. And really, with rules that have sort of stood up over the test of time, there have been literally an annual effort to try and redefine the presidential nominating system, and it virtually never goes with any real significant reform. And so the process isn't going to really change the way things are. And one of the little figurations of that process that most people don't pay a whole lot of attention to, at least within the Republican Party, other than people like me who obsess over it, is independents get to vote in the first, you know, four or five primaries and caucuses, and not counting Iowa. And so so that tends to define what kind of nominee you get out of the system. And it's not until later, when that process closes up and you have, you know, closed primaries, that that really it starts to become a little more focused on ideological differences. So that process hasn't changed. Those are still going to be the rules of the road in 2016. You're absolutely right. There's always a process that develops where you have a establishment candidate that winds up, you know, going through a series usually of candidates, at least in our party, to the right of them. I think it's exactly the opposite in the Democratic Party, where the establishment candidate has to then fend off, or not fend off in the last go round, a challenger from the left. And so I think that there's nothing that I've seen that dramatically is going to change the dynamic. Campaigns matter. Candidates matter. I think, you know, what we saw in 2012 was a relatively weak establishment candidate. It wasn't that the conservative challengers to their right were particularly good. It was just that the ultimate nominee just, you know, probably ran a really lackluster primary campaign. So it lasted longer. It looked more competitive. You know, the money was still gravitating toward the candidates that won. The issue set was still pretty much the same, and the voters that showed up on primary day mirrored pretty closely the voters that we'd seen in 2008. So I guess the message there is, regardless of polarization, candidates and campaigns matter.
Can I just draw one point that Rick just made that I think is very important? And that is the example you point to of the early the caucus in Iowa, the characteristics of the early primaries. Characteristics of those early primaries do tend to pull the choice back towards the middle and away from the extremes, because they are open. And it's akin to the point I made about California. If, on the other hand, you look at where the money is coming from, and most of the money in American politics now is narrow, agenda-driven money. It's coming from narrow and agenda-driven sources. It's driving the party primaries and the primary electorates, the closed electorates, to each end of the spectrum. And I think that it's the consequences of that, those developments that is producing the kind of polarization and the orphaned voters that we have all over the country.
Good segue. I wanted to turn to David. So a fair amount has been said about money in politics, and your organization is interested in that. And broadly speaking, there are a lot more players in the game today than there used to be, not just parties and candidates, but groups, many of them ideological, but some of them more closely aligned with parties and candidates, some less. Do you think that's a good thing for our politics?
Well,
in what way?
I mean, who's to say? I mean, it's in the eye of the beholder, obviously. The people that like to be able to speak would like to be able to speak, and if we pass laws saying, no, you can't speak because it's not good for our politics, I think the people whose views are censored would say, no, that's not good for our politics. I think one of the beauties of our system is that people can speak. At least if you can speak, that's a way of relieving some pressure. If people aren't able to speak, they might try other things that people wouldn't find as pleasant. So I I think the idea of letting people speak without limit is really important. I think the campaign finance, the people that call themselves reformers, which I think is a silly thing because there's no evidence that any of these reforms have done anything to improve our politics, our government, or anything. There's no evidence that any of these reforms have improved anything. So I think we should let more people speak. We should let more money into the system. And I think these are all good things. We also have lots of artificial limits on parties. As he said, we have limits on independence. It's I think, rather silly. If we're looking for alternatives, I think we need to have people be able to fund alternatives. And one of the things, I mean, we're talking to this is New York University Law School, right? Most of the people going to law school today were born after the modern federal election campaign laws that we have. They are not familiar, for example, with the primary challenge of LBJ by Gene McCarthy. That was funded by a handful of people, literally, who gave the equivalent of about $10 million in today's money. So Gene McCarthy could challenge LBJ principally on the issue of the Vietnam War. He announced very late in the process, I think it was something like October or November, which against a sitting president. So if you imagine something like that happening today, okay, we're going to have some sort of backbencher senator announce against a sitting president in New Hampshire, like 2 or 3 months from now, everyone would basically ignore them because it's very difficult to win a race like that. But if suddenly you have $10 million and you can focus it in New Hampshire, then maybe something different would happen. And that's exactly what happened. Gene McCarthy probably couldn't have run the campaign that he ran if we had the laws that we have today.
Okay, so I'm going to mildly disagree, because I think in the last election we actually saw somewhat the equivalent, which is maybe the money didn't go directly to the campaigns, but you had individuals spending enormous amounts of money behind single candidates in the Republican primary to keep those campaigns alive, not dissimilar at all to the Gene McCarthy model. But actually, when it comes to national elections, there are now two kinds of money. There's the traditional sort of large donor money that it tends to be institutional, tends to be, you know, sometimes agenda-driven, although less on a national level than it is in Senate or congressional or gubernatorial. And so you have the kind of traditional Democratic and Republican donors, the business folks, the, you know, in the Democratic Party, the traditional donors. And now you have the internet donors, which it is amazing to think that it was only in the year 2000 that the FEC actually agreed to allow campaigns to raise money on the internet. And it actually makes it possible. I can see two scenarios for Gene McCarthy under today's laws. First, in the Democratic Party, somebody running an anti-war campaign against an unpopular war president could raise a lot of money really quickly on the internet. And we saw that, because we saw that actually in the primary challenges of 2006 and 2008 in the Democratic Party. And the other thing is, you know, somebody can just form that super PAC and go spend the money for Gene McCarthy in New Hampshire. So it's an interesting time when it comes to money in politics. I think that it is healthy that the process has been opened up to so many small donors. David and I might disagree on the role of those large individual donors being able to go and basically fund individually an entire presidential campaign. But my prediction is that you're going to see the next generation of money in politics will be the individual candidates. We've seen a little of this, right? But with the enormous amount of money and wealth that's being accumulated, people spending their own money on campaigns, which is in many ways the purest kind of money to voters, because they feel, one, that person is incorruptible because they have so much money they don't need to go break the law or get corrupted. Two, they don't have to go make deals with interest groups in either party or either side. And three, that because especially if they've earned their money as opposed to inherited their money, there's this inherent American, that's great, they should be able to go spend that money any way they want. So I actually think that that is a trend to look at as well. And those people will be very non-aligned.
Yeah, but yeah. There's definitely a trend, but there's also a trend for U.S. senators, too. I mean, the party committees, they love to go out and recruit people who are independently wealthy because they can put a lot more money into the campaign, and the parties may actually be able to skip doing any spending money in that state and can spend it some other state. I'm all for, you know, rich people running if they want to run, but I also think it would be provide more voter choice if the rich person could give money to someone who may share that person's views and may actually be a better candidate, either with better candidate skills or better political skills. I mean, anyone that works in this area, that works in Washington, that's dealt with candidates, there are people that have good political skills. It's an art to be able to put together and make change, positive change, work with people of different stripes, different parties, and not everyone's good at that. And just because you're rich doesn't make it that you're going to be good at that. So I think it's great that you can do that, but I also think it would be even better if a rich person could give to another candidate who might be better. An example of this might be, say, Steve Forbes. He didn't have the best candidate skills. I don't know how he would have been as an elected official. We'll never know. He never served, right? But I think he probably would have given a lot of the money that he put in his campaign into Jack Kemp's campaign. And, you know, it may have been a different result if something like that had occurred. And I think we'll get more and better candidates, maybe, you know, whether they're centrists or not, but I think we'll have more choice and more competition if we can do that. And if the voters are suspicious of the connection between a Steve Forbes and a Jack Kemp, you know what? You can vote for one of the other candidates.
Well, Harry wants to get in. I just want to let you know, after that comment, we'll open it up to the audience. So if you're ready with your questions, go ahead.
Quickly. The transparency is important. People ought to know where the money's coming from. That's, to me, critical. But the more, and I respect, I really do respect your point of view. However, I'm not comfortable with the idea of money defining, in the end, access to the platform and access to the ballot. And yes, it may be Steve Forbes paying for someone else to be on the ballot, but it is still money that's defining too much, I think, access to the speaking platform and access to the ballot.
Okay, we're going to go to the audience, and we have microphones. Again, when the microphone comes around, if you can identify yourself, and we will go right there in the back, and the microphone's coming right there.
My name's Steve Weitzman. I was in NYU 65 in government, NYU Law School in 68, 69. I'm a Republican from the Bronx. The only one in my law school class who I remember as a Republican was Rudy Giuliani. My feeling is, and my thesis is, that the Democrats missed a great opportunity when the Tea Party was originally forming. I thought of the Tea Party as a progressive movement in terms of the late 19th century, where people were just fed up with the way they were being treated economically. And part of this is how you get people to vote against their own economic interest. What I saw at the beginning of the Tea Party was anti-government, not the president, not the administration, but the lobbying, that people thought everything was being moved against them, that they were losing more, that indirectly the wealth of the country was moving in a wrong direction. And I thought I saw the Tea Party being co-opted by some organizations that saw it as an opportunity to move it to an extreme right and fund various people on the right so that movement was no longer populist. I shouldn't have used progressive. I should have used populist earlier. A populist movement. And now I see that populist theme coming out of the president in terms of emphasis on the disparity in terms of salaries and wealth in this country. And in that direction, I look back at the early Bush years and I see the goalposts in terms of tax reduction being moved. So now we debate on a compromise where the goal line now is up to 40 for one team and zero all the way back at the goalpost for the other team. So I'd love you to address, and this goes to some of your issues, on money and what money is doing to this country.
Well, I don't think it's possible to overstate the corrupting influence that political money is having on both the political process and capitalism. I don't know very many executives at large corporations or small businesses in Maine or in America who are excited every time someone comes to them and says, you've got to put $100,000 into this campaign or the other campaign, because that's really not why they're in business. I think that the money has, as I've said, I'll say it again, I think money has narrowed the parties. I think it's shrunk the parties. I think it has pushed the parties to the two ends of the political spectrum. And I think it has left an awful lot of people bereft, if you will, in a political environment that has the characteristics of a duopoly, that is, where there's no choice. They can't go out, no matter how much there is a demand for loafers, if the rules of the marketplace are left to the two, in this case, the two political parties, well, it's unlikely that loafers are going to go on the market, going to be found in the marketplace, because the duopolists are very happy with the duopoly. I mean, you know, they like it. It works for them. It's not working for an awful lot of Americans. And there's an article in the New Yorker, I think in the December 2nd issue, by Jill Lepore, I think, whom I don't know, but she made the observation at the end of the article that the one thing that maps pretty well with the problems we're talking about today is the widening gap in America, and in Maine for that matter, between those who have and those who have not. That's a huge problem for this country, and I don't think we're going to fix it with the kind of rules we have today.
But it's interesting. You talk about the role of money, and someone who wants to come up with a new, you know, party or back an independent, the rules make it extremely difficult to do that. It's not going to come from internet fundraising to generate a new political party immediately. I think you need something to jumpstart it, someone who's a visionary, willing to put their money into a new party or maybe a candidacy like yours, and get it launched. Now, Maine's perhaps different, but in a different state, it's you don't have the same factors that you have in Maine. And if someone were to say, look, we're not satisfied with the Republican and Democratic parties nationally or in a certain state, there really isn't an option to start a new one. There would be an option, just like everything else. If you build a new business, you can go to, you know, venture capitalists, or if you have a new view of philanthropy, you can go to people who believe in, you know, whatever it is you're trying to do, and get the seed money to launch something new. If you want to do that with a political party, you can't.
Look, I agree with just about everything you've just said. The rules that we have in place today are problematic. They're problematic for an independent. They're most problematic for the people of the United States. And it's the characteristics and the sources of the money that is flooding into the system that is creating the problem. And yes, of course, someone else can flood money into the system, or a group of other people can flood money into the system. But there are reasons why that doesn't happen under our current set of rules. I suspect that
it's illegal.
Exactly.
And I suspect that if you and I got together and talked about the kinds of rules that would work to provide choice, which is really what people want, we'd agree more than we'd disagree.
I hate to have to cut it off there. We are on a tight time schedule. Senator Deschel is going to come in for the next part of the program. It's been a great panel. It could go on for longer, but let's thank the panel.